essentially coming out at different stages, different communities, going back into closets, pretending you never came out, and you know, coming out to society, to your professional, your co-workers. So there have been different stages. The first time I think I acknowledged it was to a close friend of mine when I was curious to go to a gay party and to see what it was like. He was kind enough to come there with me and whatever, but then he gave me lectures for months on how I should get married and all that. Anyway, and then was my folks, my dad and mom, who are really well-read people, like Nanita was saying about her parents, well-traveled. My mother was a Bharatanatyam dancer. My father has been with an international airline traveling the world. And I expect them to understand, you know. So initially, they suspected it because they found a letter from someone that I was dating at the time. They confronted me, my father confronted me, and he lured me into a sense of security and said that, you know, it'll be fine. You know, whatever it is, we are with you. So I fell for it and I said, yeah, you know what, I'm gay. And really? And so who do we deal with? So I said, well, some cousins and you know, some friends, whatever. And that full drama. And all hell broke loose. He took away my passport. I was supposed to travel abroad. My mother was the worst affected, who has always been my best friend. She felt very let down. I remember these words. She said it reminded her, it made her feel like how she felt when her father got cancer. And I felt very guilty to have hurt my parents like that, because they're very loving people, and you know, I've never seen them so hurt. The next 3 years, I had to live my life. Now they knew, and the good part of it was that I suddenly felt very liberated, because the thing that you're most afraid about is people blackmailing you that you tell your parents, you know, and suddenly that fear was not upon me anymore. And I was liberated, and I went abroad. My father gave me my passport very gratitude, and I went abroad. For 3 years, I didn't talk to my father. When I came back with my partner, I took them a long time to even have dinner together and all of that. But this was in 1998 to 1999. This time around, you know, the relationship that I'm in, I've been with somebody for 9 years now. He's a part of the family. He also flew with an airline. My dad and he really bond. Okay. His mom and my mom are both South Indians. So they really bond. We take holidays together. You know, and Aligarh was for me very cathartic. I wanted to put out something that was bring out a character who I felt would be dignified. And I wanted to show my parents, you know, a character who lived with dignity. You know, it was still around him, but he lived with dignity. And it worked. My parents were moved and made a very good difference.
Apoorva, thank you so much. Very courageous of you to share this and very inspiring. Apoorva, so thank you very much for that. I appreciate it. Shreda, would you like to share your journey with us? Because I would imagine it would have taken quite apart from the circumstance being different to be heading a movement like this at the film festival, and making sure that the impact of this is discussed at a much wider level, apart from being an artist and a filmmaker. So what has been the journey from the beginning to now that made you do this to where you are right now in the movement?
I mean, I come from a very small small town near Bangalore, very conservative family, not really educated, not really traveled, and so the contrast of this. So I don't think the word gay, homosexuality, none of it really was even in my domain. So the lot of anxiety and guilt about feeling that desires one felt when one was growing up, not finding that word, not finding a connection, not finding anybody else who we could talk about. So I'm talking about more of the 70s and 80s, at that time I was growing up in different. So thankfully, I actually started studying in a hostel where I felt a little more liberated to be who I would be. But again, nobody spoke. Nobody ever spoke about. We would have sex perhaps, but never talked about it. It's just something done in the dark. Never. So it was literally when I came to Bombay and I came to IIT, that's when I think I did meet one of my friends who was my classmate who basically started coming out slowly in the 1989 in Bombay, there was the first magazine. He designed a magazine. And when I looked at the magazine, I said, what is this? How can you have a magazine printed about homosexuality? You know, I mean, this is scandalous. But then I also, when I took it back to my room and started reading it, I realized that this actually is what I feel, and this is what a lot of people around the world are feeling. So I kind of connected my personal to the political in some sense. And for the next issue onwards, I was on board as one of the designers. So it was a pretty, I went to a lot of gay parties and, in Bombay and said that I'm straight. Because I'm really about. So, but I was kissing somebody out there in the corner. So it was really kind of difficult to admit to oneself as a late bloomer in that sense. And then difficult to admit to oneself and difficult to admit to people around you. But I think being part of Bombay Girls and some of the people whom we kind of met together, what was interesting, we kind of had an alternative family system kind of thing where a lot of us got together, felt extremely comfortable with each other, shared our personal stories. And then when we did Bombay Girls, and we kind of worked on Bombay Girls, worked on Hamsafar Press, which is a big Bombay, it kind of really connected to a larger circle, and then you felt that, okay, here is what one wanted to do as a person, connect. It's nothing like activism is not something that you do, it just happens to you in some sense that like you just give a voice to what you feel and it connects to somebody else. My mother asked me, okay, I'm okay that you're gay, I'm okay that you're homosexual, but you don't have to really talk about it. So I said that I need to talk about it because maybe there's somebody, say, Arunachal Pradesh, somebody in some corner out there who's completely lonely and maybe he or she reads about it in some bit somewhere and feels that he or she's not lonely and there's something. So that's the journey basically, and then I was doing a lot of mainstream television and I just felt what I was doing was interesting, it got me money, it was like fabulous, but there was no scope for our own stories. So that's how I started making my first film, Gulabi Aaya Hai, in 2003. And then on, we kind of made continuously films on LGBT issues. Not that the only thing I wanted to, I want to do all kinds of stories,
yes.
But I just feel that it's important for me to do these films. Because I feel compelled that like, these stories need to be told. So sometimes I know that like, I'm a bit, I would say, very inward looking in, with the fact that like I'm very politically correct about what I say. Sometimes my aesthetics and my cinematic ideas take a backseat, which for me is extremely limiting as an activist, I mean, as an artist. But the fact that these films can be utilized as a advocacy tool by people to possibly create change, have dialogue, I mean, that is more important at this point in time. Perhaps things will change, perhaps I'll make things which I aesthetically believe in or cinematically believe in, not really be kind of very underlying each album or goal I understand. So I'm just hoping that the journey happens in some sense. But I still feel, though I've been there for the last 20 years, I still feel it's the beginning of the journey.
Then we have another round of applause for his national award for best entry for becoming nominated. I'd like to ask how all of you look at, well, specifically the law, 377, where it stands now, with the Supreme Court going back to referring to the Constitution bench after all this journey going back and forward. What do you might be specific steps? What are practical steps that might actually take it forward? Where you, because sometimes things are not always logical. For example, when we have, I would imagine, I don't know, you would be much more articulate in this. When we have, for example, unexpected family support and amongst and that, whoever coming out. It's a very different thing from other than the lawyers who are anyway fighting for it. It's at different levels. So where do you see a priority in taking the movement forward and changing the law?